Andrew Nordin is our next presenter. He's one of the two first place winners, and who is just starting up his new lab at the Texas A&M this summer. And as I said, he received one of the first place prizes with this paper, Human Electrocortical Dynamics While Stepping Over Obstacles, which was published in Scientific Reports. In this paper, they constructed a novel dual-layer EEG electrode system to isolate electrocortical signals. The independent jury was particularly impressed with the novel use of hardware in this particular paper, and rated the work as very highly for the knowledge gained in the MoBI field. So if Andrew is ready, I would like to make him a presenter. Very good.
All right, are we all good there?
Yes, we're good.
Okay, so yeah, thank you for the introduction. Obviously, thank you to Brain Products for the award as well and the hardware. Very much appreciated. So just to start off, as it was just introduced, I'm just starting as an assistant professor at Texas A&M University by way of University of Florida and University of Michigan. So if you can connect the dots there, I'm coming from Dan Ferris's lab. Okay, so what I study is neural control of locomotion, and unfortunately, piggybacking off of Scott's comments and the disappointment in the biomechanics community, I'm a physics-trained biomechanist, so I guess that puts me in the crosshairs for Scott's disappointment. But essentially, I came into this world wanting to learn more about neural control of locomotion. And, you know, as a biomechanist, I was predominantly using kinematic measures, surrogate measures to understand movement control and typical electromyography or electromuscle activity. But you might ask the question, why do we even care about what the brain is doing based on what we know? You can control a lot of elements of locomotion without the brain's involvement at all. So, you know, we have basic reflective or reflexive behavior. We can see reflexive stepping. We know central pattern generators can produce stereotypical locomotor patterns in decerebrate cats and spinal cord injured subjects through electrical stimulation. But of course, as it's come out through all the presentations, we have all this sensory information returning to the brain, and if we have to change our gait pattern in any way, that's going to involve supraspinal input. So obviously, to move around in real world environments, or even just respond to stimuli, we're going to need more than just simple treadmill walking that's unperturbed. In particular, if you go outside, you can imagine the world is very complex. You have a lot of different things on the ground. You have to worry about tripping hazards. So what we don't want is, you know, to fall on our face when we're moving out in the real world. So of course, we study this in the lab in this case, using mobile EEG. Scott and Klaus have demonstrated the progression of this over time. Here's another video you can see in the background of Dan Ferris's lab at Michigan when we were collecting data. So essentially, as all of you know, high density EEG that we typically collect, there's sensors all over the head. In this case, we're suspending the recording equipment. This is biosemi equipment suspended above the person and with some wires. So, you know, we're getting all of these small voltages from the brain while people are moving around on the treadmill. Looks great while someone is stationary. And then you run into this nightmare scenario where if you have someone walking, or at worst case scenario, running on a treadmill, the fluctuations in these signals are basically at face value unrecoverable. So it's essentially just following the accelerations of the head, you know, the result of the ground reaction force moving up the body. So how do we address this head on? If we want to understand anything about what's going on in the brain, we're going to need to understand the causes of motion artifacts. So what's causing all these fluctuations in the recorded signal, and ideally come up with solutions. Okay, so this was following up on some work. So another previous winner of one of the MoBI Awards, Anderson Oliveira, had first started doing some work using phantom heads along with Dave Harrison's group at the Army Research Lab out of Dan's lab, and was essentially using artificial heads to generate signals so we can start to understand how these signals are contaminated through motion. Now, in this case, what you're looking at is a mannequin head. Underneath of the electrode cap is a dental plaster material, and there are wires going into this head creating voltage dipolar sources. So we can put EEG equipment on there and actually record, you know, what's coming through the head based on us knowing what we're putting into the head. So in this case, this is the dental plaster material. We have some sources embedded in the material. So you can see essentially what I did in this case was I have six antenna, I then put through sinusoidal bursting activity. So in this case, you know, it's still relatively simple, but this is each one of the antenna is just doing this bursting activity, totally randomized at very specific frequencies. So the reason it was specific frequencies and they were independent is that we should then be able to recover all of those, right? So in a perfect world, again, if the system is stationary, we can get these voltages measured from scalp EEG. Unfortunately, if we start to move this system, so in this case, 1 degree of freedom motion platform on the right is what you're seeing recorded at that time. So knowing what we should see versus what we do see, this is obviously a problem. So we want to know if we can get back to this and especially back to those ground truth signals. Now, the way that we went about this was essentially coming up with some new hardware. So standard EEG, this is an example of active two biosemi electrode. So relatively small, this is obviously zoomed in. Now the side profile view of this, you can imagine if this is the scalp of a human or of the dental plaster phantom, you have the electrode well, you inject some gel into there, insert the electrode, you're then recording the voltages from here, and the wires run up. Okay. Now, what we did was obviously, if you're recording from this sensor, you're going to have a mixture of brain activity and motion artifacts. So, to overcome that, what we did was this is the exact same setup on the right here with this guy added in. So, in this case, what I did was I took an isolated noise recording by taking a flat type biosemi sensor, so right here, inverting it and then mechanically coupling it to the primary recording sensor. So what we're getting here is the mixture of motion artifact and brain signal. What I'm getting here is purely electrical noise and motion artifacts. So movement of the sensor, movement of the wires, all of that, and I have these bundled wires exiting together. Now, overlaid on top of that is a secondary cap. So I have gel inserted here. But essentially what this is doing is it's acting as an artificial skin circuit. So this actually is a conductive type of fabric. I've used a few different types at this point, but like I said, it's overlaying this, totally independent from the human, and we're therefore able to get these isolated noise recorded. So in terms of form factor, what you can see, if in the traditional single electrode setup, you know, place these small sensors all over the head, deal with the wires. In the dual electrode setup, you know, you have two sensors, so the size is a little bit larger, you bundle the wires together, but essentially it's the same premise, same setup. So you insert all of the electrodes, and then you're going to set up these secondary length electrodes, which are already coupled to one another. Then at that point, you overlay this conductive fabric. So right off the bat, what you might notice is that because this is overlaying everything, you also get some mechanical advantages of just holding everything more securely to the head. So you will inherently minimize some of the motion artifacts just by virtue of that overlaid cap. Now, in terms of collected signals, this is actually occurring from two fully independent systems. So the one on the left, this is the analog to digital converter or the biosemi collection box. So this is recording in all of our scalp recordings. So that would be our mixture of brain and potential motion artifacts. The other system is, again, just the noise. So one approach that I first developed was, how can I leverage this signal to clean this signal? And the approach that I took was through frequency domain noise cancellation. So simple approach here is just do a fast Fourier transform on both of these and essentially take anything from this signal out of this signal by canceling problematic frequencies. I then reconstruct this signal after removing the problematic frequencies And you can see I've removed some background electrical noise as well as motion effects. So the benefit of using the phantom head setup is that we know what we can send through. We can do typical recordings with a single electrode setup and then also the dual electrode setup. So all of the data that we collect in that dual electrode setup, the noise, the mixture, and then the clean signal here, you can see somewhat of a difference there that'll show even more on the next screen. So I already showed you the 1 degree of freedom motion platform. Now what we did was we actually acquired a 6 degree of freedom motion platform. And actually, to Scott's point about the biomechanics side, what is driving this motion is actually an inertial measurement unit placed on a subject's forehead while they're walking on a treadmill. And then essentially what I can do is I can take the linear accelerations and angular velocities, calculate the positions, and then, you know, generate this motion trajectory of someone's head while they're walking. So this is actually from somebody walking at 2 meters per second. That's quite fast. It's actually a speed where you prefer to be running. And then in this case, this is a live stream of the recordings coming from the sensors on the scalp. So you can see some bursting activity, some electrical noise. Over here, this is after cleaning. You can see what's left is basically only this bursting activity. And that, you know, I can compare back to my ground truth and know that, in fact, that's removing basically as much noise as possible. So the correlation here was in excess of 0.95 between the ground truth and what I was actually getting after cleaning the data. So that's all great. The nice thing with that approach is it's fairly computationally cheap. So I can do that in a sliding window. But for most of us who work in this area, we actually want to get to the ground truth sources. So what we're measuring at the scalp is a mixture of those sources. So to get to those independent sources, as many of you know, we're using independent component analysis. So again, what I want to get back to are these original bursting activities using my dual electrode setup. So I probably don't need to go into too much detail on this, but you can imagine if I have four sources inside the brain, they're all sending out electrical activity. By the time you measure them at the scalp sensor, so these are your scalp EEG sensors, you end up with all of these sources mixing by the time they get to the sensor. So we want to get back to this. We do that through ICA unmixing. Now I'll go into a little bit more detail for this group than usual, but you don't need to pay attention to all of the individual signals here, but just imagine each one of these is a recording from an EEG electrode. So if we have 40 EEG electrodes overlaying the scalp, each one of them will be getting all of the signals, including motion artifact. This is collected during phantom head motion and the bursting activity, depending on its proximity to the source. Now, typically what we would do is put that channel data into ICA, and ideally we're going to get a bunch of noise sources back and also our ground truth sources that might be spread out. So what we wanted to do was compare how can we possibly improve this, especially in conditions where we have a lot of motion artifacts. So an alternative approach of what you can do with the dual electrode is essentially take, you know, your standard 40 scalp EEG channels, record that mixture of brain activity and noise. You also have all of your 40 channel isolated noise recordings. Now what you can do is use that as the input into independent component analysis, and now you get back 2 times the number of components. Now the premise behind that is if I have more components, ideally I can spread those ground truth components or spread the noise into more components and more accurately isolate the ground truth components. The other idea behind it is that if these signals are contained within here, these should assist in actually pulling that out. Now, what we actually see was exactly that. You can go to the paper for more detailed description, but essentially because I was sending through independent frequencies to each of these sources, so looking down at the head, what I should get back is each component should show a very distinct frequency peak. So here's the time series, the voltage fluctuations projected back from the components. And then what we see is the independent components in the frequency domain. This would be spectral power. The units are not very important here, but you can see the frequency on the x-axis that are going to match up with the various frequencies. So we see one peak in each of these. So I now know I'm getting back what I was putting in. And actually I was only able to get this completely independently when I was including additional sensor data from the Duo electrode. So that was encouraging. So with all of that in mind, obviously we wanted to then throw this on humans and see, can we do a better job of cleaning? Here's mostly for demonstration purposes, but with these tools in hand now, you can imagine doing the same thing that I showed you on the hexapod with the phantom head, now with somebody walking and running on a treadmill. You can see the raw EEG that would be coming in, and I can apply my channel-based cleaning techniques or the independent component analysis approach as well. But we now know that we can clean these data relatively effectively. Okay, so the question is, what do we actually want to learn about neural control of locomotion? Well, as many of the presenters have outlined today, vision is a big part of that. So as we're navigating the world, we often encounter things that we need to modify our gait pattern around. So in this case, we wanted to go in with a hypothesis about what areas are probably going to show activity. In this case, we relied on some basic science from Drew and Marigold, who were studying cats and obstacle avoidance. So if you put a cat on a treadmill, have it walk, introduce an obstacle to it, basically it has to see the obstacle and then decide how to place its paws around that obstacle and step over it. Now, what they did was they implanted electrodes into the posterior parietal cortex of the cat and tracked the spike rate. So this is the actual neuronal activity in posterior parietal cortex. This would be when the obstacle appears, and here's where the cat is stepping over the obstacle. So what you see is before the cat even starts to step over the obstacle, the firing rate is increasing. Now, by the time they're over it, it actually decreases. So it would seem that posterior parietal cortex is involved in observing the outside environment, tracking obstacles relative to the body, and determining how to place those limbs around the object. So naturally, we want to try the same thing with humans using non-invasive scalp EEG. Now, in this case, the subjects are walking and running on the treadmill. We took them through a wide range of speeds. In this case, 0.5 meters per second is actually probably fairly common for most mobile EEG studies. It's quite slow. 1 meter per second is around typical human walking speed. Some maybe closer to 1.5. Like I said before, 2 is quite fast walking. You want to be running. And then we wanted to see, can we even get anything once we move up to jogging and running? Okay, so I already outlined what we were potentially expecting from posterior parietal cortex. Now, based on a theoretical model, again, from Drew and Marigold, we would also expect the involvement of motor cortex. So in this case, if you know a cat or a human is going to see an obstacle, the motor cortex is going to have to send a signal to the spinal cord and adjust that gait pattern. We're also going to expect a somatosensory cortex, posterior parietal, premotor, basal ganglia, cerebellum, just to name a few. But you can see what I've circled back on is the involvement of posterior parietal, and then of course the visual areas, which we had already seen Klaus refer to earlier today. So we now know we're expecting to see some activity in these areas. The question is, can we recover that with scalp EEG? So I'll just quickly run through this because most of you are fairly familiar with EEG processing, I would imagine. Like I said, the only difference is my approach to ICA. So in this case, if this is your scalp EEG recording, I can leverage my dual electrode data and put that into ICA, recover components. At that point, I can take the components, model them as dipoles, fit them to subject-specific MRIs, take all of those dipoles, cluster them within ports of the brain, identify the area, and then I can do time frequency analysis, which several authors have already outlined. Essentially, what we're seeing is a three-dimensional plot here where we have time on the x-axis, we have frequency content on the y-axis, and then coming out of the screen in the red, blue, and green is going to be this gradient of spectral power in decibels. So red is going to be increase in spectral power, blue is going to be decrease synchronization in red, desynchronization in blue. The last step is going to be significance masking that. So basically anything that's green is not a significant difference from the baseline. So it's not a significant change in spectral power. Now, one thing to keep in mind here, so I already outlined frequency on the y-axis, spectral power change coming in and out of the screen, but in this case, I'm mostly interested in actual events, not absolute time. So the events here are when the obstacle appears on the treadmill. So in this case, the subject is walking or running on the treadmill. From behind this curtain, an obstacle pops out. So this little green guy here pops out, and then the subject has to plan how to move around that. So the next event is going to be when the obstacle is directly under the subject. So that was determined from biomechanical data, tracking the velocity and position of the obstacle relative to the hip marker, and then once the actual obstacle has left the treadmill belt entirely. So what do we get back from this? Well, we see involvement of three specific areas very clearly, one of which is supplementary motor area. So in this case, we see a very tight cluster on the midline. And essentially what you're seeing is soon after the obstacle appears on the treadmill belt, you see this synchronization in activity basically in alpha and below. So you're seeing this large increase in spectral power before the subject even gets to stepping over the obstacle. So this is appearing as though this is the subject identifying the actual stimulus here, which is the obstacle. You also see activity, which in this case happened to be lateralized. I'm also seeing some interesting things coming out of follow-up analyses, but in this case, you were seeing a stronger response from left premotor cortex. So you would anticipate this as the subject seeing it and starting to plan how to interrupt their gait cycle. And then posterior parietal cortex is then tracking where that obstacle is relative to the person and how to step over it. So again, all of these areas are responding before the subject actually modifies their gait pattern and actually steps over the obstacle. Now, because I collected all of these data at different speeds, I'll just quickly run through the response at all the speeds, but it turns out to be pretty similar. So again, we're looking at supplementary motor area, 0.5 meters per second. You see the response synchronization soon after the appearance of the obstacle on the treadmill. You see a very similar response at all of the walking speeds, which is encouraging. And you see it all the way up into running. So it appears, you know, independent of speed, you're going to see a fairly consistent response in terms of frequency content. There are some differences in timing, which I'll get into in a bit. And then you see something very similar in premotor cortex and also posterior parietal cortex. Okay, so we're seeing similar things independent of speed with some details that are going to differ. So in terms of what this actually looks like, I'm actually going to show a video here of a subject running on the treadmill. These are the same three areas, same plots, frequency, time, the events, and I'm going to play in real time how quickly this occurs. So this is obviously one of the huge benefits of EEGs, that we have very fast recording time scale. So if I press play, the obstacle pops out, he steps over. Basically, too fast for you to even see what happens, so I'll slow it down. Now what you see is the obstacle appears, the brain activity goes off in the white tracer bar, the foot placement is planned, and then they're over, okay? So very quickly that happens, but again, the brain activity is preceding any interruption of the gait cycle and placement of the limbs around that obstacle. So to give some more biomechanical context here, this is now a plot of the vertical ground reaction force scale to body weights of the subjects. This is actually the ensemble of all of the subjects. And now what I'm showing is the foot placement or the actual vertical ground reaction forces, the stepping sequence around that obstacle. So the events surrounding it, the vertical line is when they're stepping over the obstacle. Again, this is when the obstacle appears. So what you see is the step nearest the obstacle is here. This is one step ahead. This is the penultimate step. Now, what I'm showing here, the gray lines are just the heel, strike, and toe off events, but the colored bars here are the actual timing of when the brain activity is occurring. And what you notice, this is stance of one of the limbs as the person approaches the obstacle. You see the brain activity is firing in the penultimate step. Now, this happens to be at 1 meter per second, but again, we can look at all the speeds. And what you notice is This is now all of the walking speeds, but the big takeaway here is that essentially two steps in advance of stepping over this obstacle, the brain activity always tends to be occurring, other than in this last condition where it's just coming so quickly that it starts to happen in between these steps, but the timing is fairly consistent relative to the step sequence before stepping over the obstacle. Okay, so with all of that in mind of what we learned leveraging this technology, you might still wonder, well, what difference, if any, is the dual electrode specifically making? So in this case, I've already shown you this plot, the general synchronization soon after the obstacle appears, and this is after cleaning. So this is what we actually got out of the previous plots that I showed you. But of course, we have the isolated noise recordings from those secondary sensors. So what I can do is I can actually run an analysis without using any of those signals and just look at what would happen if I process strictly the scalp interfacing sensors. So in this case, it would look something like this. And we see some similarities. We still see a response sort of in theta, but we now see this suspicious looking content that extends all the way up to high gamma. Now, fortunately, because we have those secondary sensors, I can look at what's happening in them and see that overlaps directly with what I would have been interpreting. So in this case, I should then be confident in ruling that out after my analysis with the dual electrode sensors and return back to this. So in this case, you know, we're back to our original interpretations I just outlined, but we have much more faith in what it is we're interpreting. Now, potential applications for this moving forward. Some researchers are already moving to this, looking at aging populations in fall susceptibility. So Dan's group is now looking into this. Another group at University of Central Florida and Helen Huang's group is looking at aging populations. Many of the presenters today have also alluded to or mentioned athletic applications. And potentially, if you take this technology, what would be amazing is to be able to really push the boundaries of what we can do with the cleaning, obviously moving towards completely wireless systems, which are now being developed. So Dan's group is developing the wireless dual electrode system as well, and potentially applying that to say how an elite athlete is planning their foot placement as they approach a hurdle. Okay, so with that, just want to say thanks to Dan Ferris and Dave Harrison for hiring me on to work on this project. Also the funding that the Army Research Lab provided. Dan also has funding through NIH and NSF, and then the students who also spend University of Michigan and University of Florida, Brian and Ava. And then just one quick plug again, because I'm starting my new lab now. If anyone is interested in doing a PhD in motor neuroscience, you can contact me here at my Texas A&M email address.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I see one question in the chat from Klaus. Klaus, do you want to ask it or should I read it? You're muted probably.
Like the moderator mutes me, I can't unmute me. Yeah, so thanks for the great talk. I find this super impressive, and I think this is like a really good approach for future movie recordings in general. I just so my question would be, why do you think this noise specifically? I mean, we see that in all the early walking studies using MoBI, we have like this high frequency activity, right, broadband up to the gamma range. Why would that be like broadband, and why would you see that high frequency noise? What is your interpretation of that?
Right, so I think it's a few factors. Obviously, it depends a lot on your mechanical setup. So, you know, in a lot of studies, you'll see the wires are a little bit more freely moving. I think that's going to introduce a lot more high frequency content. You still see it in my setup, which the sensors are held more securely to the head. But of course, you still have, in this case, it's a wet setup. You have the possibility for the gel to move. You also have the cables themselves moving, potential tribal electric effects. So there's still a lot of things that you can do in terms of cleaning this up and eliminating sources. What we saw in one of our papers is also tracking it to cable movement. So in this case, you know, I bundle everything together. Because of that, it should move that frequency content down in terms of increasing the mass or inertia. But of course, more cable movement is going to introduce the potential for more artifacts. So moving towards wireless systems where everything is on the body, ideally where you're digitizing right on the head. I mean, that's the ideal and a very simple way to eliminate a lot of those potential high frequency sources.
Okay, thank you.
Scott has a question. Just a second, you're muted.
Scott.
Thank you. So a frequency transform of a spike is also high frequency. So that could that lead to spike-like movements, or pressure on the skin scalp or the scalp and gel interface?
Yeah, but the interesting aspect is that complete broadband, right? It's like
I mean, if you take a if you just take a click and you put it through a 4A transform, you'll find that that's great.
Yeah, it is also sort of an artifact of the analysis as well. Fortunately, though, as I showed in that over in the overlapping ERST, it is largely taken out based on that frequency domain cancellation. And you know, I've published methods since then that are also relying on component decomposition approaches to just pull out those different components and specifically clean those. So there are a lot of options for focusing on very specific frequencies that are problematic.
Yeah, very, very, very nice. Really nice results.
Hi, Andrew. Can I ask a question?
Yes, of course.
Can you guys hear me?
Yes, we can. Go ahead.
Yeah. Thank you for. I love this paper. I was wondering. So all your action is in planning to negotiate the obstacle. And are you surprised that you don't see anything when you step over, like when you execute? There seems to be no action there. Are you surprised?
So I think to some extent, it's just relative to the analysis and the magnitude of the response. You see it very strongly prior to stepping over. You see that in the spike rate of cats stepping over. In this case, it's very unexpected. You don't have a lot of time to step over, so you have to, there's somewhat of a startle response there as well. In some of the follow-up analyses, though, I am able to see during the actual step over, you are able to see some lateralized effects depending on which limb is also stepping over. So, you know, there's always things to follow up on, and you know, different iterations of the analysis can reveal different things. But certainly from this initial analysis, it was identifying that response to the obstacle quickly appearing and then planning how to get over it, which that strong response is happening before they even reach the obstacle.
Yeah. But you were subtracting out the all the EEG dynamics that were supporting the normal running, correct?
Right, exactly. In that case, yeah, like Scott says, your baseline also matters, right? So
the baseline would have the control of the ordinary treadmill running, which unless you're very experienced on the treadmill, is not all that automatic.
No, exactly. And that's what we see when we do this analysis from the same data set of the event-related spectral perturbations tied to the gait cycle. Yes, you do see those lateralized spectral power fluctuations, similar to what others have seen before in terms of the frequency content and the timing.
Thank you.
Okay, I guess there are no further questions.
Yeah, sorry, there's one more, Pierre.
Okay, please, go ahead.
They asked me to read it out for them, so I will do. When you use the dual layer EEG, could you reduce the processing step? Also, which method is the most effective for pre-processing?
So yeah, in terms of how to decrease the computational cost, so I've developed several methods. There's a follow-up paper. It's in IEEE Transactions in Biomedical Engineering. So that shows a comparison of different processing approaches. So kind of compares the straightforward single electrode approach, my frequency domain, channel level cancellation, artifact subspace reconstruction, and some new methods using canonical correlation analysis, principal component analysis, combined with my frequency domain cancellation. So fortunately, the noise cancellation, the spectral cancellation is quite low cost, but doing any pre-processing, removing the artifacts before putting them into ICA absolutely assists in what you get out on the back end. So in this case, I was using a pretty passive approach of just give ICA everything. It definitely improves things. Once you move towards looking at actual brain signals tied directly to the step sequence, doing pre-processing through component decomposition, whichever approach you want to try, I lean towards PCA and CCA for that, and then cleaning those components before ICA is absolutely has been the best approach that I've seen. And you can implement those in pretty quick approaches that don't require a lot of computational cost or runtime on your computer.